Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals of any political or gender identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh shit!
My pickle Ray! Motherfucker! You are now watching STS.
Because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in old times. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted a written imprint of boot on the face of history since the beginning of time.
Dog will hunt.
Fuck, suck, and eat butt.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
And there we go. How's it going, Starflies? Welcome to my poopcast. This is STS, your safe space from the Magatards, as well as the SJWs that are just completely oversensitive, and seems like nobody today can take a damn joke. We're starting off a little bit off today because, honestly, I forgot to break up my weed before we did the show. So, I haven't said this in a while, but this week's blend is actually that of bubblegum. And it's actually brought to you by Bubblegum Cherries from Bay Flavors. This is what I got. Let's see if we can get a good view of it. And, yep, these are actually really delicious. And you definitely get a nice sweet taste out of it. It burns really soft. It's not a quick burn. So a lot of times I have trouble with certain strains will tend to light off, and it's like almost like a controlled flame where the fire is so suffocated that it's only living on the bottom of the bowl, so it's consistently smoking, which means you're wasting weed. You know, that means your weed is being smoked without you. And so, I really like this blend. I really like the nuggets, and I really like the flowers. The florets themselves are very soft and fluffy, but also very sticky and condensed at the same time. So, it's a very good strain. I suggest you try it out. Let's go ahead and take this off. This thing is starting to bother me. So, today started out like any other day, and you know, watching Lewis Black and talking about the ridiculous idea of the benefits of slavery. And I ended up just in an argument over a situation that, of course, is a very touchy situation and topic that people have literally stopped watching the show because of it. So whatever. Truth is truth. Honesty is honesty. But what I'm seeming to have a problem with is one of the main stations or one of the main channels for the truth movement is now ostracizing their own people. And it seems like if you're a debunker, you seem to get better treatment than those that actually keep the channel running. And you know, to put it in a reasonable analogy, it's like saying, you know, you have a Taylor Swift fan page and you get a bunch of people that are, you know, maggots and juggalos all saying, hey, we like Slipknot and ICP. Well, obviously, You're not supposed to be on a fucking Taylor Swift page. Excuse me. So, we really have a control problem with the trolls themselves. So, we have no control. We just have a troll. And it's getting to the point where I've noticed that, I mean, this is nothing new, but when you have 6 or 7 different accounts just so you can go around and troll everything you disagree with is absolutely astonishing to me. Why anyone would go out of their way to make all of these bogus and pointless profiles simply to harass those that you disagree with. It seems like that's a really good way of falsifying and fudging your own numbers. So it looks like you're being attacked from a few different people, but it's actually the same person just flooding the chat box or what have you. And so what I find really annoying about that is that these people get away with it. And how does this make sense that you would go and harass these people, and then when you're proven wrong, you just hide behind the numbers? For instance, an argument regarding the truth movement, one person kept trying to use the claims of eyewitness accounts, and you have to remember the 9/11 commission didn't even take in real fucking testimonies of eyewitness accounts. Otherwise, you would have had over 100 of them talking about explosions. And this wasn't from the basic left or the leaning left. This was from police. These were from police and firefighters. And again, you have to understand that Rudy Giuliani has been this horrible person, just a wretched, treasonous bastard since I've known anything about him. And, you know, when I was a kid, I liked Rudy Giuliani because I remember seeing him in Seinfeld, and he seemed like he had a sense of humor, and he was more fun than R. Mayer Daly. And so I kind of used to think, like, man, I wish we had a really Rudy Giuliani, you know, because Mayer Daly is not like he's going to go on, you know, the closest thing we have to Saturday Night Live in Chicago is probably WGN Morning News or something. But even then, I mean, we have a comedian on that show, Pat Tomasulo, who is an absolute phenomenal, he's a great comedian. He's married to his awesome wife that is stuck by him. He's got a great family. But again, you would never see anybody joke with him on WGN News, which he's probably one of the most quick-witted people. And he started his own show called Man of the People, and it was the first thing cut off once WGN had gotten bought out. And they just took out, you know, a promising Chicago comedian's chance at, you know, providing Chicago with a great new show. And it was starting to go, you know, national. So the whole point of today's episode is just talking about the lack of control that we actually do have, since everything seems to be so free for all now, where we don't have control of our own, you know, education system. And when you look back years ago, you have to remember that originally the Republicans did not want the government to own schools. They wanted the Board of Education to be a separate entity from the government. Now, parts of me does agree with that. There is a part of me that understands that and believes in states' rights. And you know, when it comes to like a historical curriculum, you know, you do need to know about national history and American history. But sometimes, you know, instead of doing either European history, that doesn't really matter, they should have some form of community-based history, you know, teach kids more about where they live and what's been done, you know. I like telling young musicians, for instance, that, you know, if you live in Rogers Park and you're around this whole area of Lincoln in California and Peterson, when you get to this little area, I like to remind younger musicians, younger bands that, you know, the guy from, I think Chevelle's guys live down the block. I think David Germain's family, somebody else lives out in Rogers Park. And the simple fact that even Eddie Vedder was born in Evanston Hospital at St. Francis. So I like to give people that little bit of community history, the communal history, because it helps them. No, it just helps encourage them that, hey, somebody else has made it within the same, you know, circumstances that I lived by. And again, there are so many great musicians that should have kept going, but they just had no opportunity to continue that because we no longer have any control over our own public community systems. Like, for instance, I had made a point about the churches in our communities. They should actually foot the, you know, the floor plan when it comes down to community dances and stuff like that. You know, I understand the church is under no obligation to pay for all these things. We should kick in and do this as a community. But I believe that the church should provide us the space because A, you have it. B, you are in a more, you know, you're in a safer zone because if any shootings go on in a park district near a park or a church, usually the crime gets more attention and you usually get more time if you were to commit a crime like that. So I think that that's a huge part of it. And if we had some form of community that was allowing us to get along and get to know each other, I think that would put a lot of, at least some resistance to the amount of shootings that go on. I remember being a kid, my mom used to go to the CAPS meetings and they would go to the high school and the police would give them a rundown of what was going on, you know, and address the issues. Families and citizens could simply ask what's going on with this issue in the community and, you know, why is our fire hydrant not being fixed? These are community problems that need to be dealt in within the community. So I understand that standpoint of smaller government and government shouldn't have so much reach that it controls everything. But we also should have no control at all either. There should be a middle. And what the middle is, in my eyes, is us, the communities, the actual cities and the actual citizens and residents of that community. You should be able to have a simple meeting where it's not fighting over whose grass hasn't been cut, but instead what's going on in the schools. You know, the neighborhood school has been getting a lot of graffiti. Is there a way we can combat this on our own peacefully without having to subject to a good guy with a gun? Instead of a good guy with a gun, how about just a good guy, you know, or a good girl, whatever, a good person, all right? You know, so the idea of community has to live. And if it doesn't, then we perish with that. And so when they say it takes a village, they mean a community. The village is a community. And the church in that community has every obligation to fulfill the, or at least provide a space for these places to thrive and be able to meet. So when I mentioned the CAPS meetings my mother used to go to, when they talk about, well, what's going on? If they were changing police, they would let us know. They're going to change our, because they did this around the 2000s, around 2005, I think. They had altered the way that we had things, where we knew all the police on our block. We knew all of them. We knew them by first name, and even the gangbangers knew them by first name. And so that is what you need. You need the police to be a part of the community. You need a fucking congressman or an alderman to live in the very district that they represent. I am so sick of seeing senators that live nowhere near where you live, but they are the ones in control of it. It makes no sense. And then they have the nerve to, for instance, one shut down the idea that Mark Zuckerberg wanted to help give money and I believe build something for this one state, and literally said, well, an out-of-stater outsider should have no business in our state's politics. That seems very ignorant to me, because again, we're all one country. And maybe Zuckerberg was actually trying to just give some money to help out with something. Maybe he had a personal reason. I don't know. But why would you say no to free money that helps your own infrastructure and helps your own interior? Why would you say no to that? I will never understand that. I find out that this very guy, I want to say this happened in Ohio, but the very same guy was entirely being funded by an out-of-state, out-of-towner fucking guy. And it's just amazing how much of their funding comes from these so-called outsiders. But if Zuckerberg is an American citizen, that's not an outsider, all right? And so if an outsider, someone from California, wanted to give Chicago and Rogers Park's, 48th Ward, they wanted to give us, let's say, like $2 million. Why would we say no to that? Yeah, give me the money. Give me the money. Give me the money. And we'll figure out something. The problem is all that money gets funneled to individuals rather than an actual entity that can be controlled, monitored, and understood. Instead, you have slush funds, funnel systems, and more shell companies, are born every day. And it's terrifying. And the idea that we have no control is even more terrifying, because you're not leaving it up to the states to decide. You're not leaving it up. It's now becoming a one-size-fits-all country, which will never make sense, because that's the whole point of states' rights. But at the same time, states' rights does not mean to go off and think that you're a country within yourself and you can go and take away things from the Constitution. Constitution and Bill of Rights is just a basic template for all states to understand and follow, since we follow one republic. So we are one democracy. And so Republican, Democrat, they both mean the same fucking thing. So, whenever someone says it's not a democracy, we're a republic, but the republic is a form of democracy, you stupid prick. So, you cannot live your life over-controlled, and at the same time, you cannot live a life with no control. So there has to be the medium. And again, the medium is us. And so it's our job to fulfill our duties as citizens and as human beings to love our neighbors, help our neighbors, and show a good example. And then we need to actually start a system where we learn our local politicians. Make it a website thing, make it an app thing on your phone, but we need to get away from the system that has no control within itself, and we're simply voting by color rather than by person. I should be voting for someone based on their actual policies, not what color box is next to them. That seems pretty fucking irrelevant to me. And 9 times out of 10, it's the independent that has the best idea, and nobody's going to vote for them because nobody knows them. So again, alternative media, more community, church obligation, these are just a few steps that I think would have a huge benefit on our country and our individual states. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. I've been wrong many times, but I just don't see how I can be wrong with this one. So yeah, that's my time. Noticed nobody was here today, so that was fun. Maybe I'm starting to get stigmatized because of what I talked about, but again, we cover a lot of topics on here. And I think another problem that we're having is the fact that I really don't like talking about celebrity worship. And some people ask, why aren't I talking about Jamie Foxx or anything? And I think that sometimes we need to get the fuck away from celebrities. But since someone mentioned the Jamie Foxx thing, honestly, I don't even know what to believe anymore. I thought it's highly suspicious that no black celebrity seems to be able to keep celebrity status. I think it's fucking really strange. We only have like one major black billionaire in this fucking country, and that's Jay-Z. I think it's fucking weird that, you know, every black comedian ends up somehow ruining their career. And I noticed that after the Jamie Foxx situation with the supposed rejection of taking any kind of vaccination, not being, you know, he and Ice Cube saying the same thing, you know, what pisses off the big club the most is when you don't want to be a part of their fucking club. So he lost out on job roles because he wouldn't get vaccinated. And it wasn't that he was anti-vax. He simply was not sure and was a little afraid and wanted to wait until we had more information on the actual drug itself that would show that it's actually helping. Now, that seems to make sense. It seems very, very plausible and very reasonable to step back and go, wait, I just want to see how well it works, and then I'll go get one. But since he had like a deadline and he did not want to risk it, he lost a very large role. I'm not sure what movie it was. And then Jamie Foxx is supposed to be doing this big role with Cameron Diaz. Suddenly he won't get a vaccination shot, or then he does get a vaccination shot. I heard he said no at first, and then he got the vaccination anyway, and then suddenly he's having these reactions to it, which really scared a lot of his fans, because nobody deserves to be blind and one eye paralyzed and all these crazy things just from one shot. It's just a very, very frightening situation. So the fact that he did not want to do it and then acquiesced, and then suddenly all these problems happened, and now I can't help but notice everything on YouTube with a thumbnail that has a picture of Jamie Foxx, and it's done by anything Hollywood Incorporated. It's talking about how he is doing something wrong, I just noticed a couple of different very negative lights on Jamie Foxx for some sort of decision. And it will not surprise me if suddenly they say that he, I don't know what they're going to make up, but I have a feeling that he's going to get a bunch of shit that they won't have actual proof of, but they'll claim it. Now, when you talk about guys like Puff Daddy, now Puff Daddy is a totally different breed. People like R. Kelly, Puff Daddy, Usher, these guys were very different, and these guys were all a part of the same kind of club, and it's really strange that Puffy's wife can die so suddenly, but not be able to be given a cause of death for like a month, I believe. Possibly more. I've heard 1 month and I've heard 4 months. And so it does not take that long to diagnose a posthumous flu. That's not hard to diagnose. The lungs will have fluid. There's telltale signs of influenza. So the very idea that it took months to get this prognosis or diagnosis, this final diagnosis, and a, COD, cause of death, it's just really strange that you're going to go with a very basic problem that could have been recognized instantly, especially at an autopsy. So the fact that you got Eminem's, saying, sorry, Puppy, you know I love you, that whole joke. And then you got him making, Puff Daddy making jokes about wrestling naked with Usher at a very underage age. He was a very young kid at this point, and he's talking about wrestling naked over cornflakes or something. That's just fucking weird. And the way that Usher has his face, like, why the fuck are you telling this story, bro? And all the threats that his wife was making towards the idea of, I'm going to fucking expose you for that, the fucking creep you are. It's very strange to go from that period to death. And that she was, anytime a person has to start telling you that they're not sick, they're in perfect health, and it's basically a way to say, hey, if I end up dead, you guys know who did it. Whenever I see a message like that, it is very disturbing and it's concerning. Only when Marjorie Taylor Greene did it was all of it. I think I just couldn't care less. And I wasn't wishing that someone would hurt her. I just knew that she's full of shit and she probably doesn't know how laptops work. And then, so when she noticed a hotel TV trying to connect to a laptop, yeah, there could be someone next door trying to connect to the Wi-Fi and put it on the TV. That happens all the time. Sometimes my downstairs neighbor, his TV shows up on my TV. It happens if you have the same kind of programming and the same kind of televisions and appliances. Well, guess what? If you're in a hotel, they buy all the same goddamn products and appliances. So that's what you're going to deal with. So when she cries wolf, couldn't care less. As for people like Jamie Foxx, who has actually been a good person, and look at Bill Cosby, who was like the fucking epitome of family, and the way that his career went down. Now, I'm not saying that he didn't do what he did. I'm just saying that I think if he was white, they would have waited till he died and then brought out all these horrible things. Because then by then, there's nobody to sue. I do find it very unsettling that when it comes down to black people, they always ruin their career. Look at Martin Lawrence, Chris Tucker, even Oprah, but again, that's definitely nefarious. But when you look at people like Oprah, Bill Cosby, and there's also, you know, crazy deaths. I've told you guys about Sam Cooke being murdered by the mob because he was pushing forward with Martin Luther King. And the, how's it going? Welcome to the show. So the fact that Sam Cooke gets a phone call from Sammy Davis Jr. telling him to back the fuck up and don't, you know, don't be following Martin Luther King. He's going to walk you straight into a barrage of bullets. And so Sam Cooke literally tells Sammy Davis Jr., go fuck yourself, you fucking turncoat pussy. And, you know, he ends up dead shortly after. So that was not, that's not a coincidence. So, yes, I find it very strange that with black celebrities, they have like a fucking, it's like they have a fucking expiration date at all times. And look at what they did to Richard Pryor. I mean, Richard Pryor had to make fun of himself to get out of that. Eddie Murphy, they tried to destroy him with a tranny thing. And then and his hatred for David Spade. That whole situation with him and Saturday Night Live, I didn't understand it because all David Spade did was retell a joke that Eddie Murphy made. So if anything, it was actually an homage to Eddie Murphy making fun of Eddie Murphy. So that's clever to me. But the Martin Lawrence thing where he's standing on top of cars saying they're trying to kill me and we're supposed to believe he's crazy. You got Bill Cosby, you have Kanye, you have, and again, yeah, sure, there is their own nefarious reasons and it's their own evil and sometimes it's their own stupidity. But regardless, it seems like you guys have a lot more control when it comes down to the white celebrities. You back them up, you fucking rewind and backpedal all the shit they say, you give them representation. But when it comes down to all these black celebrities, I don't see the same kind of, you know, backbone from everybody else. It was really strange. And I think that's why I was so goddamn happy to watch that Alabama brawl, was because it was such a great way to show that we are not a fucking minority anymore. Now, I am not black, and I'm not trying to say that I'm black, but I've never been accepted in a white culture, so I'm not white either. And it's just, you know, the fact that we have been treated as this minority and been called minorities. Meanwhile, we've been fucking. And we've been making more of us and more of us. And as long as we keep on fucking, there's going to be more of us. And so stop with this minority bullshit. We're all Americans and we're all here and we've fucking been here. And that's what's most important. No matter how much you try to destroy us and put us fucking down, you have no fucking control. There it is. All right. Appreciate y'all for watching the show. Thank you so much for your time. It will be uploaded to YouTube. Again, it's great to have the show back. I love having everybody here. I love having my chat box and my nice little kick-ass soundboard. So let me get a let's get an applause for that one. I want more. Appreciate y'all for watching. See you on the other side. Most of all, stay cheesy, my friends.
Welcome to STS, brought to you by Useless Agent. This program is not meant to discredit anyone's social or sexual identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Please grow a pair and enjoy, or stick to Fox News. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
I was broke. I was go out and rob some more. We ran everything. We paid off cops, we paid off lawyers, we paid off judges. Everybody had their hands out. Everything was for the take. And now it's all over. Now it's all over. All over. All over. All over.
Welcome to Useless Agent. Enjoy.